Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Thank you for coming to this retreat for formation retreat. Now also formation in our faith and knowing better the sacrament that the church has for healing. For healing, it's a sacrament for healing. The church has as a mission taking care of those who suffer and are sick and are in any kind of trial in their lives. In fact, Jesus identified himself with those who are sick. When you visit a sick person, you are visiting Jesus. And the church knows that from the beginning. It's Matthew 25, when Jesus told God, the last judgment, and the last judgment is all taking care of the poor. And one of the situation of poverty in human life is in sickness, illness. When we are sick, we feel strongly our weakness. I'm also aging, and I am 58. I am 80. So I know that when you are more than 50, and you don't have any pain, because you are dead. So it's not so bad to have some pain sometimes. You know. I wake in the morning and my finger is okay. I have a pain here every day, constant and permanent. So okay, I'm alive. I am not getting here. In heaven, there is no pain. But there is important to understand a little better what is this sacrament that the church has. Is one of the seven sacraments instituted by Jesus. Jesus, when he sent the apostles to preach the gospel, it's in the gospel of Mark, he sent them, anoint the people, and heal them. And St. James, that is one of these apostles, have this expression that is what we read when we give the anointing of the sick. So we understand that it's found in the scripture, not because the church has invented a sacrament, no. Are there any who are sick among you? Let them send for the priests of the church, and let the priests pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick persons, and the Lord will raise them up. And if they have committed any sins, their sins will be forgiven them. That is a quote of James chapter 5. That is there, it's written, the priest read it when he's going to give the anointing of the sick. It's a prayer of the church. You know, in the Old Testament, people face their sickness before God and ask for healing before God. And we have also to face our life in such a way, because always sickness is a call to conversion. And aging is a call to conversion. I mean, God is calling us because, I mean, every kind of sickness, as the Catechism of the Church talks, when it's talking about the sacrament of the anointing, is reminding us that there is death in our life. And we have to be afraid. I mean, if we are walking toward God, the fear is less. If we are not walking toward God, the fear is greater. No. I mean, it depends on us. Depends on how we love God. If I love much more God, can be that happened in my heart of Santa Teresa of the Child Jesus, that was 24 years, and I want to die because I want to see God. I mean, why? Because she loved God. She loved God a lot. But the night is not a joke. I mean, the night, we was reading it 2 days ago, the night of Friday, Holy Friday, she was very obedient to the rule. So she was at bed and she has a vomit. She didn't know what it was. And she waited until the morning to see what it was. And when she saw that was blood, was so joyful that God was calling her to go with him and preparing for an encounter with him. I mean, these are the saints. I know that it's not everyone. First week is not the same, but I mean, the saints desire to see God. So always our age is saying us, we are walking toward God. No? So simple, so obvious. I mean, it's not a big explanation about that. Everyone knows that we are here from childhood, from we know that we are going to die. And it's part of our human being knowing that. The animals don't know that. We are humans because we know that. And it's very important in our awareness because that makes us holy. In fact, you know, in the beginning of the Bible, the second chapter, God said to Adam, don't eat from the tree because the day you eat, certainly you will die. And that is the word of God. It's God that loves Adam, saying him to be aware of death. Because death is connected with his action, it's connected with sin, it's connected with good and evil. I put before you life and death, happiness and suffering, cursing or blessing. You choose. This is something that is coming constantly in the Old Testament. This option, we choose. But Satan, you know, the first temptation was, first is, no, you will not die. So we original sin come into the world because in the human conscience was denied the fact of death. I mean, I don't want to put fear anywhere, I mean, because it's part of our life. And in the Eucharist, we celebrate always the death of the Lord until he come again. So God is wanting us to face death. If I don't invite you to face death, I will be a very bad priest. I mean, if God, Jesus, put at the center of our faith the Eucharist, that is the memorial of his death, according to St. Paul, don't say the memorial of his death and resurrection. No. When he talked about the Eucharist, he said the memorial of his death. We celebrate. Of course, we cannot celebrate the memorial of his death if we don't accept the resurrection. But, I mean, so it's important that we, because putting before death and putting before God is the same thing. There is no difference. You can put before death and only fear, you can put before God, understanding that for seeing God, we need to pass that moment that is part of our life. And it's good to embrace it. And that is what the sacrament is for healing. We don't ask that the people pass, no, we ask the people to be healed by God, in the spirit and in the soul. So don't think, oh, I am going to wait until I die. Okay. Any sacrament is for dying. The sacraments are for the living. So, when the priest go to give the sacrament, what he's asking you is your healing. Your healing in the spirit, your healing in your body, and a strength for facing the moment of suffering, because suffering is always a moment of solitude, a moment of loneliness, a moment of pain or despair sometimes, and he's trying to help us in the spiritual dimension, so we receive the Holy Spirit for strengthening us and being before suffering stronger. And also join our suffering in case I don't receive the healing to the cross of Jesus. Jesus took our sufferings. He embraced our sufferings. And we are, all Christians are invited to join their sufferings to the cross of Jesus. It's the greatest thing you can do. I mean, it's better than prayer. It's better, the greatest thing that we can do for the church, for those we love, and for ourselves and our holiness, is embracing our sufferings and joining them to the one who takes first our sufferings. For what? For you and me understand that we are never alone in our sufferings. He's there with us. He has taken them before with us. And he's accompanying us with the grace of the Holy Spirit so we become holy in what is happening in that moment. But depend on you, if you refuse. I mean, God never obliged us. He invited us to cooperate with him in the salvation of the world. And you can cooperate a lot in the salvation of the world. In the degree you embrace the thing you have in your life. But the sacrament has this goal that is the healing. Usually it's accompanied before by the act of contrition. And it's good, I would like, I mean, when I am in suffering, the first thing I will do always is confession. I mean, I know it clear. I will look for a priest for confession, and after that, the anointing of the sick. Why? Because the first thing I have to do is to clean myself before my God, and I'm bringing the things to light, because this is the way he's going to receive the grace in all its power. I mean, because we believe in it, and they are connected, because the other, I don't want to pass. When I am in my time, pick somebody who knows me, and I finish like this. So, wherever I am. So, what I think is very important is we understand the sacrament not at the last rite, that there was an expression that has we, majority of you, is the way you understand the sacrament. Why? Because was usually the people are so afraid that they only call the priest when the person is dying. But that is not the call of the sacrament. The goal of the sacrament is healing. And that is very important. God, is God going to heal us? We don't know. We put in his will these things. But what we know with absolute certainty of faith is that he's going to heal us in the heart in the measure we open in faith to him. Because he's also trying to provoke the faith of the person who is receiving the sacrament. It's a preparation first, an invitation to open his heart. It's reminding baptism that is dying with Christ for living for God. And baptism is the first action of Christian life. So, and that is sacramental way of living. And that is dying to ourselves for living from God. That is baptism, but this is something that is all along human the Christian life. We have to be always dying to our ego for living from God. Dying to selfishness for living for love. I mean, that is part of Christian life. And if we are living that, we are not afraid of death. Fear of death is coming, you know, the sting of death is sin. And when I keep myself in selfishness, of course, I have a lot of fear. More selfish a person, more fear, obviously. More loving is a person, less fear. Why? Because more knowledge of God. God is love, and those who love know God, because God, love is coming from God. But it's a challenge for us, always. The anointing has three things, essentially. First is the prayer, laying the hands on the head of the person. It's the epiclesis of every sacrament, and here is that. The priest prayed in the name of the church. And prays in the name of the church. It's not only the priest who is praying, it's the church who is praying for that person. So, the second is the using the anoint. The anoint is the oil, that is an oil that has to be blessed, usually by the bishop, on the Christian Mass, that is the, usually the Wednesday before Holy Week in the Wednesday, with the other oils that we have there, the oil of the six, that is used in the forehead. And the prayer that the priest says is a very beautiful prayer, very short, but it's the essential of the sacrament. The sacrament is always a physical gesture. All the sacraments are the same, are physical things with the word of God that is giving meaning to the human action. So, and God is working through both. The sign, the physical material thing, the Eucharist, the bread and the wine, and the words of the priest also. In marriage is the consent of both, and the action of God there. Every sacrament has the material dimension and the words that give meaning to the action. Confession, the same. Is the priest, is the act of the penitent and the absolution of the priest. They are essential part of every sacrament. Here is these words that are beautiful when the priest anoint the person. Through this holy anointing, may the Lord, in his love and mercy, help you with the grace of the Holy Spirit. Say, amen. May the Lord, who frees another hands, the palms of the hands, both, may the Lord, who frees you from sin, save you and raise you up. I mean, that is the prayer. It's a beautiful prayer, invoking the Holy Spirit for coming for him. I mean, you can receive the anointing how many times you need it. For example, a little child can receive anointing, yes. If he's going to have a surgery that is some kind of grave surgery and with difficulties, he can receive the anointing. every person who is sick with a sickness that is some kind of dangerous, if I have a pain or I put my finger pain every morning, that is not reason. Because it's no risk. It's when you have some kind of danger or in the sickness that you have. In that case, everyone can receive the anointing of the sickness. The church recommended to be united. That is something we can talk with the pastor, Father Javier, is having the sacrament of penance, the anointing, and the Eucharist. Because the goal of every sacrament is the Eucharist. So that is the Viaticum. The Viaticum is the expression, is Jesus accompanying you in the way. But it's coming from in Spanish, in Latin is the way. That is the meaning of Viaticum, is God in the way with you. And Jesus never leaves you. He is always with you. And he wants that presence be stronger in the moment. The Viaticum is for receiving communion, receiving Jesus, for being with Jesus. I mean, Christian life is an encounter with Jesus. When we receive Jesus in the Eucharist, his presence becomes stronger in our hearts. And so that is what the Viaticum is inviting us. It's the last of the sacraments, for accompanying the person toward his way toward God. We are here in a way, in a pilgrimage. And we have to understand our lives in that dimension. When we don't understand our life in that dimension, we have a lot of problems. I mean, because we are running away from our meaning as being humans. Being human and being in a pilgrimage is the same thing. It's no different. If I'm not living my life as a pilgrimage, as a pilgrim, then my life has no meaning. Because death is the last word of your life. And that is horrible. I mean, and you cannot avoid that. You can stop thinking, stop being a human, and stop understanding things, but you cannot go away from the mystery of life that is a way toward God. I mean, the sacraments are for accompanying us with the love of God and the mercy of God in those moments that we need more strength and more support from the church. And that is the reason of the sacrament. And this is asking for him. I want to put this very clear in your heart. Usually it's a reading also. There are beautiful readings. I used to pray with the person who is sick, the Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall want nothing. I mean, it's a beautiful psalm for praying. Also, Jesus inviting, come to me, all those who are weary and life and find life burdensome, because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come to me. So, it's got, there are several readings that accompany to increasing the faith of the person. I have a woman, I don't know, it's here. I have given her three times the anointing. The three times she was right. Not that I did not miss it. She is coming to pass. When I say I see her, I say, many Sundays, how are you doing? Oh, very well, Father. I mean, that is the point. It's a sacrament for healing. It's not a sacrament for killing people. So you go, it's the families and the relatives sometimes think in that way. Oh no, if we call the priest for the anointing, it's because he's going to die. So they're waiting to the last moment. No, that is not the... I mean, you can call in that moment, of course, but that is not the best. The best is that the person with awareness and consciousness receive the sacrament for preparing his heart if God called him, her, but also for being and putting himself and herself in healing, in the, especially in the spirit, in the soul, and avoiding temptation and conquering temptation, because, you know, every moment suffering is always a moment of temptation. As Jesus told us when he was going to the cross, he's the first who never denies us. If you want to follow me, deny yourself, take your cross and follow. I mean, for following Jesus, we have to take each one of us in each moment of our lives our crosses. And aging is a cross. I know it. I prefer to be before that when I play better soccer and I'm tennis and now I, every day I play and I'm getting old. I'm taking me a lot of time for recovery. Before I recover the same day I can be playing in the morning and in the evening. Now I have to stop for a week. Or recovering my body. Why? Because I mean aging is a humiliation. It's God is trying to make us humble. All the body is a language of what God is talking to us. God talks to us through the body. And through your body is talking to you and to others. It's a moment of wisdom. It's a moment of power. I think they have taught you about this. But the sacraments are for encouraging the person there. It's a moment of... one of the greatest problems in this society is that many, not those here, many old people, they don't live their life as wisdom. We are witness. I mean, the children don't have witness what they are going to think. If we want to be as youth, what is they are going to think? That we don't have nothing. We are called to be witnesses of the meaning of this life and the fullness of life that we are achieved at the end of our life. Because we are called for that. And God wants to work in your heart through that. You are called to be witness of the power and the love of God, especially in this moment in your life. One of the prayers that is, there are several prayers, very beautiful, for the different situation, if it's a surgery, or if it's an aged person, or it's a person who is dying, there are different prayers according to the necessity of the moment. But what I invite you is to understand, facing a fact that is essential in our life, because we are humans in that fact, and that we are pilgrimage and we are walking toward God. But that, what reminds us that is the mystery of our death.
Father, could you also speak on if a person can receive anointing after they pass away?
I said it before, told it before, all the sacraments are for the living. They are prayers for the person who has already passed away. They are prayers for that, for the recommendation of the soul, and pray for the soul of that person. But the sacraments are always given to people who are alive. It's not a sacrament for a person who is, because they are sacraments of the living. So, I mean, they are prayers, of course, in that moment. So that is reason, another reason important, don't wait until the last moment, I mean, because sometimes you arrive, to me, thank God, it doesn't happen. And sometimes I have seen the providence of God, amazing. I mean, there was a call there, I have an appointment, and I was going to go later, I said, oh, okay, I'm going, was a place that was not corresponding to our parish. The person was not a parishioner. A lot of things for not going because it was snowing. And I have an appointment, so I can go later. But I don't know why. I called to my appointment and said, I will be a little later. I'm going to give the anointing. I went there. It was a beautiful old woman, very peaceful. The whole family was there. And I talked to her because she was a Spanish speaker. So, I mean, before the priest go, cannot. I pray with her a little. We pray. I give her the anointing, and the moment I gave her the anointing, and we pray a Hail Mary, boom. See? I was waiting. She was waiting. It's amazing. God works. Yes.
Can you give a spiritual anointing in absentia?
Sorry, can you repeat for me?
Can priests give a spiritual anointing in absentia? If somebody refuses to come back to the church and you know that they're not well, can you give like a mental spiritual?
You can pray for that person, and what we know, for example, and that is very recommended, is a person is not in the church or away from the church, or it's not the Divine Mercy chaplet is very powerful. I mean, Jesus promised conversion of people who are in the moment of death. You pray that chaplet of the Divine Mercy. So you can pray that for that person, even that person is not open to receive that sacrament. But you cannot give a sacrament the person is not wanting to receive the sacrament. It has to be a consentment from the heart of the person to receive the sacrament. You cannot oblige a person to receive any sacrament.
Father, at what point when someone has like Alzheimer's, would you no longer be able to receive this sacrament?
Yes, they can receive. I know parishes that every month or 2 months they have an anointing for the people who work after Mass, and they get anointing. In some parishes, the time we did that, and I think they continue doing that. I mean, a person can receive the sacrament when he or she is in some sickness that is, we will say, with some peril of death, some risk. It's not that he, or I mean, and since if I have a peg here in my knee, it's not for receiving the sacrament. Something that is connected with a kind of dangerous in life. And he's asking for healing, and says he's not asking for, I mean, because if we, I have a pain in my knee, I offer it to God, and that is what I so have to do with that.
If mentally someone doesn't realize what you're doing, can
he can
still
receive, yes, she, can, okay. She or he can receive the sacrament, even if he's not realizing. We don't know what is a knowledge of people when they are, even when people see that they are not conscious, the last thing that they lose is the ear. So I always invite the family, keep praying with him, hold his hand, and keep praying with the person. Because the last thing that people usually lose is the ear. So it's keeping there in a, because in that, you know, death is solitude, it's loneliness. We are born in solitude and we die in solitude. God is there, of course. But we need also the person of God, because it's very important to pray with the people when they are passing that moment of encounter with God. It's the moment of passing to the Father. It's the moment of encounter with Jesus. You know, the way Jesus described death. Do you believe in God? Have faith also in me. In the house of my Father, there are many dwellings. I'm going to prepare you a place. If not, I will not say you this. So he's saying, I mean, I'm not alive. I will come back and I will take you with me. So where I am, you may be. I mean, that is death for Jesus. It's him taking you with him. Describing death for him. It's coming for taking you back. When I am the desire of following Jesus and I love Jesus, I mean, there are many saints that, you know, the expression of Saint Paul, for me, life is Christ and death is a gain. If you ask me what I prefer to be with Christ. I mean, we are called to that love, and God wants to put that love in your heart. Have this very clear. God wants to put this love in your heart. And not because you are good. No, because he loves you. That's very different. Don't mistake things here. He is not about your merits. It's about his grace. It's about his action. And God, if I open to him in this moment, as the prodigal, you know, the good thief who was there, was not so good until he converted. I mean, he was crucified with Jesus, and in a moment, he's a saint. I mean, what are his merits, we will say? Nothing, offering the moment of death with Jesus. What are his merits? Offering his suffering in that moment, that was 1 hour or 2 hours, whatever, with Jesus. And he's a saint. See, I mean, don't think, my life has been whatever, and now, I mean, this is your head. This is not faith. God loves me in this way. And in this way, he wants to come in union with me. He thirsts for you. And now it depends on you. That you open to his thirst for you.